wild church tonight. I think y'all are kind of probably maybe a little more calm than you normally are. So, amen. I was enjoying it and just a little bit scared all at the same time. Praise God. There's no two churches that are the same. I know you're looking at me saying, well, if you don't have a church like this, how do you have it? Fred, I've been to 23 countries of the world and been in Pentecost all over the place, but y'all have a special corner on the market, let me tell you. Amen. Tommy Lake sings a song that says, if you've been drinking old wine, you need something new. You know it, don't you? Let me tell you about a high I found. I've got good news for you. You won't find it in a bar room, in a bottle or a pill. It comes straight out of heaven. Lord, I know it's real. The chorus says, have you ever been so drunk that you didn't know your name? So intoxicated with something you can't explain. But that song is simply saying that if you've been drunk in the world, that's only a counterfeit for drinking the new wine of the kingdom of God. Amen. Everything the enemy has to offer is nothing but a counterfeit. It's a fake. It's a generic. If there is such a thing as being demon-possessed, it is only because that we were created to be God-possessed. I want to talk to you tonight that the intention of creation is that you be possessed by God. See, Pentecost did not show up primarily in Acts 2. It showed up in Genesis. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7 said, God created a man out of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. That wasn't air that went in his nostrils. So the Old Testament word for breath is the same as the word for spirit, the same as it is in the New Testament. Wind, breath, spirit are all the same word. In the Old Testament, it's ruach. In the New Testament, it's pneuma. In the Old Testament Hebrew, ruach. Somebody say ruach. Now you speak Hebrew. In the New Testament, pneuma. Some of you construction workers, you know about pneumatic drills, pneumatic nail guns. It's wind power. It's the same word. It's spirit power. Amen. Once you've used a nail gun, you never want to go back to a regular hammer again. So come on, somebody. Amen. And once you understand the power of the spirit, you realize this is what we were created for. God breathed into Adam the breath of life, and we became a living soul. Now I want you to realize something tonight. I don't know what kind of preacher you're used to. I think you're probably used to some high octane, 90 miles an hour preaching. Sometimes I like to slow down and teach, and then we'll speed back up and preach. I don't want you to just go home excited. I want you to go home with something on the inside. So here, you see, a creator or an inventor knows the function of the invention before he gets started. Thomas Edison was not trying to create that light bulb and was thinking, well, I don't know what it's going to do, but I just hope it does something. No, he knew. If I get the filament right, the wattage, the voltage, if I get this thing together, this is going to be a light machine. I'm going to flip a switch, and without a torch or a lantern or a fire, I am going to be able to have light in dark places. He knew the purpose of the invention before he started. Henry Ford knew, if I get this Model A right, if I get this assembly line right, when these pieces come together, this thing is going to be a transportation machine. Now, I know our cars nowadays, they got seat warmers, they got TVs, they got coffee makers. You know, you can get cars with all kind of stuff. It may do a lot of stuff now, but the original function was that it be a transportation machine. And in that day, so, friend, if we did not evolve from bacteria, if we did not evolve from monkeys, if we were created, then the same way that Edison knew why he created the light bulb and Ford why he created the vehicle, then why did God make you?
That's
right. See, I think that people kind of think, well, he just wants me to be happy, and whatever makes me happy, then that's why God made me. That's not so. Why did God make you? Think about it, young person. If you were born with a little tag on your toe and it said, this is what this thing is for, what would that tag say? If there was a scripture scripture on it, what would it say? I know some people would think, well, we're created to win the loss, but that's not true, because there was no one for Adam to win. He was the only one, and there was nobody lost. Now check this out. God gave Adam vocal cords before there were other humans to talk to. You want to know why? Because your ability to make a noise is not primarily for another human's benefit. It is primarily that you be able to worship God. Now we're in a generation where you can communicate with another person by buttons, by phones, by tweets and messages and all kind of other stuff. But friend, you cannot communicate to God with a message. He's not just waiting for your thoughts or your heart. The psalmist says your praise will continuously be in my mouth. I encourage you, if you think you are timid or bashful or shy, do not be ashamed of the sound of your voice worshiping God. You were created to bring Him glory.
Yes, sir.
Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 7, if you're taking notes, if you're not taking notes, write it down on your sleeve, on your pants, on your neighbor's face, but do not forget Isaiah 43 and 7. It says, even everyone that is called by my name, I have created him. This would be on the tag if you were born with a little tag. I have created him. I'm about to tell you why you have skin on, why you have a heartbeat, why you're breathing tonight. Isaiah 43, 7. I have created him for my glory.
Yeah.
I have formed him, yea, I have made him. If you ain't going to say amen, just lift your eyebrows like that.
You can be filled with him who makes you holy.
With the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You were made for this. I was listening to the radio a while back, and they were talking about a man who, in the 1800s, we hadn't gone to the moon, we hadn't made submarines to go to the bottom of the ocean, but there was a place that we had not discovered that we thought was in our reach. We thought we could get to the North Pole. No one had yet made it to the North Pole, and it became a fascination of explorers around the world. Over 1,000 people tried, and over 700 of them failed and died in that pursuit. And a man from Sweden, up in Northern Europe, he was not an explorer, he just worked in a bank. But he became fascinated with the thought of getting to the North Pole first. He began to think of ideas. He began to sketch out ideas. He began to talk to his friends until it totally consumed him. He was obsessed with the idea of getting to the North Pole. When you begin to talk about things like that, other friends that don't care about it, they'll leave you alone. But the other people that like that, they begin to be drawn to it. And he found two other friends that wanted to go with him. He bought a hot air balloon, and he put sails on it like you put on a ship. Because you can't navigate a hot air balloon, but he said, if I put sails on it, then I can navigate it. He got long ropes with heavy sandbags, and he said, that will keep me anchored, and I'll only move the direction I want to. He packed tuxedos on this hot air balloon, because he said, when we cross the North Pole, we'll come down and land in San Francisco, and there'll be a parade to say, you were the first. His name is S.A. Andre. S.A. Andre boarded that hot air balloon. People waved goodbye. Him and his two friends begin to go north until they entered into a cloud. The sun wasn't there to help keep the balloon, and it began to grow cold as it drifted down. The wind began to push against it, and the rope snapped. And then he fell down to the ground. They began to hike back south, hoping to get back home, but what they didn't realize is they were on a sheet of ice that was floating northward while they were walking south. Some 30 years later, some people who were seal hunting, while they were hunting seals, they found the bones, the remains, and a journal of S.A. Andre talking about what had happened. See, you've never heard the name of S.A. Andre probably because he didn't make it. When people are obsessed about something and they don't succeed, their name is forgotten. People thought Thomas Edison was a fool. He shut himself in to a workroom and he tried over 1,000 times to create the light bulb. And had he failed, we would not have remembered his name. We would have said he was a fool. He wasted his time. But instead, he succeeded, and thank God he did. We're not in the dark tonight. We're not lighting candles tonight. He was obsessed. Now, there's certain things that this culture will allow you to be obsessed about. If y'all could tune in with me, we're about to pray. If everybody in this place could look this way, that'd be so wonderful. Praise the Lord. Listen, there's certain things you're allowed to be obsessed about in this culture, and people will praise you for it. You can give yourself to academics, and people say, you go for it. You make good grades. You get a scholarship. You're going to go far, man. You're going to get a good job. Awesome. Go for it. You'll never hear somebody say, you're doing too much homework. You need to stop doing homework and go watch TV. No, people encourage you. Go after it. Do the best you can. Let somebody show an aptitude for athletics. Have a physical physique that they're really doing well. They run fast. They hit home runs. They make all the shots. And man, people begin to scream for them. Go! Practice all that you can. Give your body. Give your energy. Amen. They see those people that go to the Olympics. They didn't just practice on Saturday afternoon. They gave their life. Everything they ate, everything they did was to train their body so that they could win the gold medal. And people are screaming for it. They're obsessed, but they're praised for it. Let somebody give themselves to the pursuit of money, becoming a businessman, starting a business, making more money. And they say, man, they're working hard. They're going somewhere. Go, go, go. Let a person give himself to God. And Christians will say, don't you know the Bible says everything's to be done in moderation? Yeah. That's the only time I've ever heard that scripture quoted, is when somebody was really going after God. Come on, friend, the only thing that is not to be done in moderation is your pursuit of God. Amen. Yeah. He said, be not drunk with wine, because even a drink is excessive. One sip is too much.
Yeah.
He said, but be filled. Be overflowing. Be saturated with the Spirit. You can take a drink of everything the enemy has to offer. It will only leave you more empty. Or you can come to the river of living water that is in Christ. And you can continue to drink. And He alone can satisfy. Because you were made to be filled with God. God told Moses, He said, make that tabernacle. He made it out of canvas. He made it out of fabric. But when he got to the Holy of Holies, you know what he told him to make it out of? He didn't make that Holy of Holies out of anything made by man's hands. Not tapestries, not canvases. He said, when you get to the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant, where the Shekinah is, you know what was to be the material? Ram skin and badger skin. You know what God was saying? He's saying, my glory is not to dwell in things made by man's hands. My glory is to made to dwell in skin. I wanted to dwell in Adam's skin, but Adam evicted me. And since I can't live in man's skin, I'll live in animal skin for a season. But then Christ showed up and he said, I'm Emmanuel, God with you. He said, God put on skin. Are you here tonight? God put on skin like a garment, like a tent in the womb of Mary. He clothed himself with skin. But then in John 14, 15, and 16, he begins to preach about the Holy Ghost. But when I go up, God's going to come down in you. He's saying he's looking for another skin tint. He's been with you, but he shall be in you. Listen to me tonight, person. Friend, God wants to go camping in Ohio. He wants to go camping in Middletown and in Dayton. He wants to go camping in Germantown. He wants to go camping, but he's looking for a tent. Hallelujah. I'm telling you. Anybody ever wanted to go camping when you were a kid, but you weren't allowed, so you just put sheets up in the living room in the bedroom? Some of y'all staring at me like, what is he talking about? We just play tents in the house. God wants to go camping in your house. Lady in North Florida, she said when we were little, we didn't just bow our heads at the dinner table. She said we got on our knees around the dinner table. She said one night we're praying for dinner, the Holy Ghost came. 18-year-old sister got filled with the Holy Ghost and started speaking in tongues for the first time. I can hear it. You see children demon-possessed and they can throw a grown man across the room. A little skinny woman demon-possessed and people trying to hold her down and she can throw them off of them. I have a missionary friend who goes to India. She says, I go out in some villages where no one speaks English, but when the demon-possessed begin to manifest, they don't speak in that native language. They speak to us in English, and in perfect English they say, we're not coming out. It's not that person speaking, it's the devil speaking. Listen to me. If the enemy can speak through them like a puppet, if the enemy can give them power to throw grown men across the room, if the enemy can animate them and empower them, but that's only the faith, and the real possessing power that we were made to be filled with is the power of God, then how much more power is readily available if we be filled with God? Not to throw men across the room, but to throw the gospel around the world. Not just to speak in another language and tell them we're not coming out, but to speak in a heavenly language and to bring the gospel into our community. God wants to put you on like the skinny people. He wants to speak through you. He wants to possess you. This is the New Testament. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Stand with me to your feet tonight. If somebody could help me on the piano, that'd be wonderful. I don't